What's up? I'm Heit.
And I'm Cheri.
And this is Axiom Amnesia. Today's discussion involves the 1997 film Eve's Bayou, and we want to talk about whether Mozelle ever told Julian, her fiancé, that marrying her would lead to his untimely end.
Mm-hmm. But before we get started, we wanted to thank all of the subscribers who have helped to make this video possible. If you want your name to appear alongside these contributors, make a one-time donation via Cash App or click the thanks button on this video, or you can head on over to patreon.com/axiomamnesia or become a channel member by clicking the join button to enjoy all of the benefits of becoming a monthly subscriber.
But those of you who don't know, in the movie, Mozelle is cursed such that all of her lovers meet an untimely end. Her third husband, Harry, has just died as a result of that curse.
We do see Harry's name on a tombstone, so the indications are that something bad has happened.
Right. It shows a spider twice. The second time we see spider, it appears to be two spiders, and one spider is consuming the other spider.
So in the next scene, it's confirmed when we see Eve placing flowers on Harry's grave. And she says, Uncle Harry, Uncle Menard, and Uncle Anderson. So these are the three husbands of her aunt Mozelle who have had an untimely passing. After visiting the cemetery where she places flowers on the graves of her uncles, Eve goes to Mozelle's house where Mozelle is still in bed and it's midday. And she's disheveled and she has a flower to bring her to. Clearly, Mozelle is completely devastated by the loss of Harry. And remember, Mozelle was the one driving the car when they had the car accident.
And remember, right before they left, she said, get in the car before I kill you.
No, just
give me the damn keys, Harry.
Now get in the goddamn car before I kill you.
And in reality, he got in the car and she killed him. Elzora tells Mozelle that she basically doesn't even have to throw out the bones to find out what her fortune is.
I don't need no cat bones to tell your fortune, Mozelle Baptiste.
And then goes on to tell Mozelle that she's a black widow. She's cursed.
You are a curse. A black widow.
And any man that marries you is going to meet his end just like the other ones. And it'll always be that way.
Next man who marries you as a dead man, like the others. Always be that way.
After the death of her most recent husband, Harry, that we just saw there, Mozelle falls madly in love with Julian, an artist who wanders in town looking for his wife who's left him.
So a guy shows up at Mozelle's door, and apparently he wants a reading or some counseling, and it is hinted that there will be a love here between Mozelle and Julian. But if you think back to what happened with Elzora, then we know that any such love, and according to this curse, if they fall in love and wed, then demise is coming for, and assured death is coming for Julian.
When Julian shows up, it kind of makes you feel sorry for him already. And in a way, you don't really want to see him get wrapped up in Mozelle's curse, because he seems like a nice guy and he confesses, hey, I've been looking for my wife for this year.
My wife left me a year ago.
And he's lost everything, so he doesn't even have a home to go back to once, if he ever finds her, but that he can't stop looking for her because he just has to know he needs an answer. And it's really quite sad, and he seems like this nice guy, and you hate to see something bad happen to him, but neither of them could fight the feeling. Julian is an artist, and he paints this beautiful portrait of Mozelle, and then, you know, it pans away from the portrait to Bow Chicka Wow Wow.
Initially, Mozelle avoids letting Julian make a commitment to her because she knows what fate he's going to meet.
So presumably some time has passed and we see Julian and Mozelle together having a conversation, and Julian is saying, hey, I gotta go find my wife.
I have to find my wife.
Of course, his wife has fallen in love with someone else, and Mozelle tries to tell him, like, look, she's not coming back to you.
Even I told you she's not coming back. She's fallen in love.
And he's like, oh, I'm not looking for her for that. I'm looking for her to divorce her so that I can marry you, Mozelle. And then that's when Mozelle kind of panics a little bit and says, Hey, you can't marry me now.
But you can't possibly marry me. I can't let that happen.
We all know why Mozelle doesn't want him to marry her, because she knows what his fate will be if he does. Then she tries to tell him the truth, and she says, okay, bear with me. And then she says, I'm cursed.
Bear with me. I'm cursed.
But instead of saying, look, I'm cursed and every man I marry meets a bad end, she says, I'm cursed and I'm barren.
I can't have children. I'm barren.
So she kind of doesn't have the guts to actually say what the real deal is, probably because she's afraid of losing him, I would guess. However, toward the end of the film, Mozelle tells her niece, Eve, that she's actually going to marry Julian. So Mozelle comes after the funeral and tells Eve that she has decided to go ahead and marry Julian, and that she hopes that God will be kind to her and maybe she can go with Julian.
I told Julian I would marry him. He wouldn't have it any other way. Maybe God will be kind and allow me to go with him. I'm tired of being left alone.
So again, we're back at this generational curse. We know that now that she's going to marry Julian, Julian is doomed, and she just hopes that she's doomed with him so she doesn't have to endure another loss like her other loss of her other husbands.
This left us wondering whether Mozelle ever confessed to Julian that marrying her would ensure his untimely end.
So this caught you pretty much up with what happened in the movie in case you needed a refresher. So here we are at the end of the movie, and, you know, she's like, I'm marrying Julian, and I can't help but wonder, like, does she ever tell this guy that your life is in jeopardy?
So I think that part of it was that she didn't really believe it per se, or you have this foolish hope, right?
Yeah.
That, you know, because a lot of times, you know, that things... We know that things are for sure, but we're like, but maybe not this time. That's why when she talked to Elzora, and Elzora basically said, yes, it's going to happen. You know, you're still under whatever this curse is, right? Mm-hmm. But she basically confirms this for you, and you're like, no, because I'm trying to forget about all of that.
Right.
And, you know, that's why she reacted that way with Elzora. Because she still has some hope that this wasn't really true.
Yeah, well, I look at it and I think that she made her decision not to tell Julian pretty much after she had the opportunity when she was trying to get him not to want to marry her. Then finally, after Louis, her brother, passes away, then we see her like, look, I just decided to go ahead and marry him. I love him. And, you know, whatever's going to happen is going to happen. And maybe I'll be lucky enough to meet my end with him. So I couldn't help but feel like that was the case. But I definitely think she decided not to tell him. And plus, in her mind, she's probably like, look, you know, it doesn't matter anymore because, you know, he's not going to know what's coming just the same way as Harry and the other ones didn't know it was coming, right? They just met their end.
Maybe it's a commentary on love, too. If you really love someone, it doesn't matter because, hey, I'm doing this for Julian, who loves me, and if, you know, he really loves me, then it doesn't matter because he still gets to be with me, right?
I know.
In the end. Because now that would make it like, whoa, this is such an amazing love story. Because that's what a lot of love stories are, right?
Sacrifice.
So I know that I love this person so much that something terrible is going to happen to me, but I still am going to choose to go and do that thing and be with that person.
But then there are some love stories where the sacrifice is that you let the person go so that they don't meet the bad end that they'll meet if they keep being involved with you. I don't know. For some reason, the butterfly effect, the first one comes to mind, where, you know, he's trying to bring her back and he finally realizes that, you know, he's the one who can't be born.
But those are the two perspectives, right? Mm. One perspective is Julian, this great sacrifice that I may die. And from her perspective, somewhat, she don't care because she looks at it that he don't care, right? Mm. And from her perspective, it's, well, I'm not making that sacrifice, right? I'm just going to go and do this. I'm not going to make the sacrifice to let him go.
If you're watching and listening to this right now, let us know in the comments whether or not you think that Mozelle ever told Julian that, you know, pretty much he was doomed from the start if he married her and decided to stay with her. So this brings me to the question, that since you and I both agree that Mozelle did not tell Julian, was Mozelle wrong for not being straight up with Julian from the beginning? Like, pretty much after y'all, you know, got it on that first night after he, you know, painted the picture, like, was she wrong for not telling him, like, look, I got this curse up on my head? And
it's multiple things. So you got the, you got this interpretation of that it's because of your actions why they're dying, right? Because you're a cheater, right? You don't tell him about those things about cheating. And another is, if it is a curse and you believe it and you tell him that, me as a man, I'm like, wait, what? What are you talking about?
So the
you
second,
cursed, in case and I'm going to die.
So we kind of have to just lay this out too. So her, she's been married three times. Her third husband, Harry, so Julian would be the fourth. So the second husband was Maynard and the first husband was Anderson. But anyway, so the second husband is the one that she had been stepping out and cheating on, and then her lover had killed him. Right. So she brought that on. But the third husband, when he died, she was the one driving the car, like we just showed you a few minutes ago. And so it's always that she seemed to have some hand in it, which always leaves it a little bit up to, is it fate? Is it the curse? Or is it just bad luck?
Yeah, because that sort of thing, you know, outside of the movie, when bad things happen to a to people, they just chalk it up to, it's a curse. It has to be a curse. Why else would bad luck fall upon me so often?
It can't be that.
But, yeah. So what if she did tell him? So one thing is, if she believes it and she don't tell him, then that's some being some dishonesty, right? But because the act of telling him could push him away, right? And if it is true, that too can push him away, right?
Yeah.
But not telling him is dishonesty, which in turn, which comes to our next point, could push him away.
Yes.
He's like, doesn't win with this guy, I don't think.
Well, she can't win with any guy if you believe the curse, right?
Yeah.
She's not going to win with any guy. You know, and it's kind of sad because really what happened to Harry, you know, I guess is a fluke accident that could have happened to anybody. I think it was, you know, she's driving. She was only driving really because Harry had had too much to drink. And that whole argument had happened.
Right, and that was the irony of the whole scene. And I like how they didn't reveal that the curse really until after this happened, because you just think, oh man, they were trying to be safe and shit just happens sometimes, right? And then you realize, wait a minute, this is something else. It probably would have been better if he was driving.
I mean, because even drunk, he might not have, you know, ended
maybe it still would have happened because it was her.
But so this idea, and to kind of get back to one of the things she said, which was that, oh, maybe I'll be lucky, you know, she's always so starry-eyed and dreaming, right? Back to maybe kind of this fool's dream, even though I know all the evidence is adding up to, like, every dude I get with, this is a bad end, I'm going to wish and hope that it will be different this time. But her dream this time is like, okay, we're not going to dream he doesn't die. We'll just dream that I go with him, right? But then it doesn't cut the same way, right? Because if she had gone with any one of her previous husbands, she'd just been gone. It'd been like, okay, whatever. No, the curse, the bad part of it, is that you have to live through it, right? You have all these losses. Like she says, she's tired of getting left behind. It's the curse to get left behind, right?
Yeah.
That's the whole thing. It's wrapped up in that. So I don't think she'll be that lucky. I think that Julian gonna meet his end somehow. You know, maybe a paintbrush will just fly across the room and impale him in the eye.
This is not a final destination. But do you think somebody from the town might have told Julian that she was cursed?
I don't think yes.
It
right?
has to happen.
It has to, because that's how he found out about her in the first place, was he was like, oh, the townspeople say you are a reader or whatever.
Yeah, and he believes in it. So back to what I said before, he probably would believe her. So I was wrong on that point. He would believe her if she said, hey, yo, I'm cursed.
Well, maybe. Listen, he might believe anybody else, but see, he's in it, right? He's already in love by the time they're sitting
but
on that
the reason I said that was that the idea that someone would believe something like that couldn't push a man away. But not just that idea isn't something that would be an affront to an affront for Julian. Somebody has to be like, hey, yeah, she's even if it's not she's cursed, it's like, man, you know, everybody she messed with, come up dead.
I know. So. He's going to be playing poker somewhere. Once he starts getting in with the townspeople or the whispers at one of the parties, you know, like the party that the movie opened with, and you see him and he's over there. Because he's become part of the family through everything else that happens in this movie. Speaking of everything else that happens in this movie, we have a fan theory completely separate from this discussion on Eve's Bayou, and it is linked in the description. And if by chance you haven't seen it, you should be checking out that fan theory.
Yes, you should, because if you abreast of fan theories and you know something about fan theories, you know, you could pick apart which parts are part of the actual fan theory, but we really go through the entire movie and what happened and, you know, throw in the bits that are applicable to the fan theory in there.
Like, yes, it's a really, it's a breakdown really good video. And a fan theory.
Yep.
You know, so, but back to this whole discussion. The question is, we agree that the townspeople are going to talk. He's going to hear some chatter about, like, you know, you the fourth one and the other three are dead. You know, as far as Mozelle's husbands. Let's just rewind for a second and say, if you were Julian and Mozelle told you that you were doomed, would you still stick around and marry her?
No. First off, like, what is you talking about? What you gonna do to me? Right? And if not, what is you know? If it's true, I'm doomed. You know, if it's true that it's a curse. If it's true that you're saying it, that something's going to happen to me, or are you going to do something to me? And are you just out of your mind by saying this?
Either way, it's bad, and you're just like, I'm bouncing.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to put my mind, you know, in the mind of a man, and this woman is coming to me telling me this in 1960s and everything. I think it depends on when she decided to tell. Because if she tells you this up front and you're not in love with her and you just slept with her the one night, it's just like, all right, well, listen, I'm going to go ahead and keep on looking for my wife, you know, and that can be the end of it. Right. But if you've already been there for some weeks and you're really starting to love, if you're already attached, the decision becomes a lot harder.
No, it don't. It did. I'll be like, so are you're being serious? And if you're serious, I must go.
So that should let y'all know that there'll be no crazy town with Heit. I can't come to Heit and be like, listen up, I'm seeing
these like
things.
Those YouTube pranks and stuff people do. No, this is not happening.
How you gonna be saying that while he's packing his bags?
It'll be video you cannot upload. No, because it's not gonna look good on camera. Like, I don't know how they do that. Like, if I'm Julian and let's say there's this camera piercing down and she comes and tells him, hey, throwing up the deuce, I'm out. There is no back and forth and laughs for you. The video is over at that point. I'm walking out the door. This is crazy.
What I'll say is just that it, for me, from my opinion, and maybe this is why I'm a woman, but from my opinion, I think it's easy to walk away in the beginning. I think it's much harder to walk away once you're already in love, even if the person is, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, because you accept them with their shortcomings and it just happens.
Yeah, but if you're talking about you going to end up dead, nah, man, I'm not there.
I mean, yeah, I agree. but because it's in this area of gray, because it's like,
okay.
Yeah, the
well,
prediction.
We take into the whole, the voodoo and the spirituality stuff that's going on in the movie.
Right. Okay, so if I'm in the movie, yeah, I'm probably going to be like, listen, it ain't going well. If it's real life, it's different because...
No. If it's real life, I'm out of there. If it's in a movie, then it's like, oh, well, maybe we could find some...
The
others.
Antidote?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. I agree with that argument. I actually like that angle. We just go on an adventure and we figure out a way to reverse El Zora's curse.
Like the cure.
Yeah.
Down in the swamps of the bayou.
That's an interesting dynamic there. If Mozelle never tells Julian, we agreed that she was wrong for that. But let's say that Julian marries Mozelle like they're planning to, and then he eventually leaves her for whatever reason, but let's just say maybe it's for his first wife. Would he still be doomed?
Oh, if the curse is real, yes, but it depends on the particulars of the curse. Do you have to still be in love with him?
Do y'all understand that in the chat? Answer that question in the comments. If Julian marries Mozelle, so now he's cursed, and he's supposed to die. And then Julian's like, hey, I'm up for whatever reason. He leaves her and maybe doesn't even go back to his wife, goes to somebody else, goes to be alone. Is he still cursed if he's not with Mozelle, but he has married Mozelle at one point?
So this curse is her curse, but it curses the men because they happen to fall in under her curse.
So can he like shake the curse off if he gets out of there?
I don't know, but I'm saying the particulars. Is the curse that while she's in love, because maybe she can fall out of love after they leave? Or is it that once you've been bitten by the Black Widow, right? Because, you know, they did compare it to like a Black Widow.
But then the spider they showed wasn't a Black Widow.
Yeah, but they called her the Black Widow.
Yes, they did.
And so I believe the Black Widow is the one who devours their mate.
Yes.
So it would have to be during, you know, while they are together. If we're going to go ride that full out, the curse out full.
Yeah.
Into that aspect of being a black widow curse per se.
So if he escapes her grasp, then he
survives. If he get out the web, he's all right. But maybe that means that
I like that logic.
Does it make him a male Black Widow? Because you can only go, once you become a Black Widow, then you have to go to another Black Widow. Or do spiders do interspecies marriage?
I think it has nope. I think if he makes it out of there, he's free. He will survive. He has gotten out of the entanglement of the curse.
I don't know. Y'all let us know in the comments.
And always feel free, because we actually read, at least right now, we're able to spend most of the day reading and answering your comments. So we do read most of the comments. We try to acknowledge them all with a heart and stuff. And when you guys have questions, we do try to answer those questions. And if you want to have more discussions about this movie or any other movie, let us know. Make some suggestions on movies you want to talk about. And, you know, we're here and we'll try to get to as much as we can.
All right, if you can, hit up Patreon or our Cash App. If you made it this far in the video, type Julian is doomed in the comments, so we'll know you're one of the real ones who watched this film to the end. And it also let us know if we're responding to somebody who watched the entire video, because if you didn't watch the entire video, then it really don't make sense for us to be responding to somebody who didn't operate on all of the information that was presented here.
That's facts. But don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel, and check out one of our other videos on the screen right now. If you like fan theories, movie trivia quizzes, and movie discussions, please subscribe to our other channel, Station B by Axiom Amnesia, so you won't miss out on any of our fun discussions.